I can't believe I'm about to start a sermon this way, but here we go. The scripture reading for today reminded me of an episode of Star Trek: The Next Generation. A rather nerdy sci-fi show which I watched regularly throughout my childhood. In the opening scene of this episode, the starship Enterprise is about to collide with another ship. The crew tries hurriedly to avert the collision, but there are mechanical problems, and the two massive ships graze each other, starting a chain reaction. Alarms sound, the vehicle shakes and shudders, and an explosion obliterates both ships. And then the show cuts to commercial. In the next scene, everything seems back to normal. Some characters play poker, including the doctor, who is called to the sick bay to alleviate LeVar Burton's character's ear infection. In her room that night, she experiences deja vu, but thinks nothing of it. The next day, as she is telling another character about her eerie sense that this has all happened before, a ship appears on a collision course with the Enterprise. The crew tries to avert the collision, but there are mechanical problems. The two ships graze each other, a chain reaction begins, and the ship explodes. And in the next scene, once again, we are at the poker table. All the characters have an odd sense of deja vu this time. Again, the scene in the sick bay, then the sense of deja vu in the bedroom, then the explosion. By the third time at the poker table, there is a sense that something is definitely awry. But before the characters can solve the mystery and figure out why they are so sure that this has all happened before, the collision, the chain reaction, the explosion. The events keep repeating themselves, with the characters getting closer and closer to understanding what is happening. Eventually, they realize that there is some kind of anomaly in this time-space continuum. Again, I can't believe I just said that in a sermon. causing time to skip like a broken record. They find a way to send a signal that helps them the next time around to avert the collision and break the time loop. At the end of the episode, it is revealed that they have been stuck in this time loop for 17 days. The crew of the vehicle they have just avoided colliding with successfully for the first time has been stuck in the same loop for 90 years and are shocked to discover that it is the 24th century. This episode of this television show came to mind as I thought about the implications of today's gospel lesson. Peter comes to Jesus and asks, "Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how many times should I forgive? As many as seven times?" Peter is actually suggesting that he offer an extravagant amount of forgiveness. In the Jewish tradition of which both he and Jesus were part, seven symbolizes completion, like the 7 days of creation. And practically speaking, the wisdom of the time would probably say one or two times was plenty, maybe even more than enough. In fact, our own culture's popular wisdom holds the same belief. Perhaps you've heard the saying, "Fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me." Right? Not anywhere near seven times. Peter isn't asking, should I be stingy with forgiveness? He's asking, should I be extravagant with forgiveness? Jesus' answer, not seven times, but I tell you 77 times, bids Peter to go far beyond. And then Jesus tells a rather odd and disturbing parable. A slave owes a king 10,000 talents. He cannot pay. And so the king orders him to be sold, along with his wife, children, and all their possessions. Distressed, the slave begs for more time to pay the debt. The king relents and forgives the debt. On his way out, the slave sees another slave who owes him 100 denarii, seizes him by the throat, and demands payment. The debtor is unable to pay, and so the pardoned slave has the debtor thrown into prison. The other slaves report this situation to the king, who summons the slave and has him thrown into jail, saying that because he did not show mercy, he will not be released until he has paid every penny of his debt. Christians have traditionally understood the parable in this way. The king is God, the king almost always. In forgiving our sins, the interpretation goes, God has offered us extravagant, almost absurdly extravagant, mercy. In fact, the amount that the slave owes the king, 10,000 talents, is equivalent to about $6 trillion U.S. dollars, depending on how you do the math. We must respond to God's mercy by being merciful to one another, the interpretation goes. But the slave refuses to do that. He refuses to forgive the debt of 100 denarii, or about 10,000 U.S. dollars, a large amount of money, but nothing compared to his own canceled. If we refuse to be merciful to others, how can we expect God to be merciful to us? So goes the traditional interpretation. And there's something to be said for it, but I have some questions. First of all, I think that Jesus and his listeners would have known that there was simply no way a slave could reasonably owe a king 10,000 talents, or $6 trillion. That amount of money is simply absurd to the point that the king's character is implicated. What kind of funny business is he pulling that a slave could be so deeply indebted? Secondly, at the end of the parable where the king reinstates the debt, runs counter to everything we teach about forgiveness. Our Christian tradition teaches that forgiveness, like baptism, cannot be undone. Forgiveness may be a process for the one doing the forgiving, but once you have said someone is forgiven, there really aren't supposed to be any take-backs. It makes me wonder whether this parable speaks not about how forgiveness ought to be, but about how forgiveness is misused in church and in society. Surely you have your own stories of such things. Forgiveness offered and then retracted. Forgiveness used as a bargaining chip or a weapon. Forgiveness demanded by the powerful from the powerless. Forgiveness taken advantage of. So how does forgiving work? How are we supposed to do it, and does it have any limits? Jesus says that we are supposed to forgive extravagantly, profligately, not 7 times, but 77. That seems like a step in the right direction. Forgiveness should be generous and abundant, like God's love. But it makes me wonder. Recently, I've been following the media coverage about NFL player Ray Rice. Rice has been suspended from the NFL after a video was released showing him assaulting his then-fiancée, now-wife, Janae, knocking her unconscious in an elevator. Between the incident and the release of the security camera footage, the couple marry, and Janae reports that she has forgiven him. I don't know about the internal workings of their relationship specifically, but I do know that forgiveness is often part of the cycle of domestic abuse. In fact, when I was studying about domestic abuse with an expert, she had a graphic showing the cycle because it is so predictable that you can make a little chart. An abusive episode happens, whether that is a physical assault or some other form of abuse. The abuser feels guilty. He or sometimes she apologizes and begs for forgiveness, promising that it will never happen again. The victim offers forgiveness. There's a honeymoon period, often with flowers and gifts, and then the tension starts to build again until another assault takes place. It happens over and over again, cloaked in secrecy, hidden from view. Too often when victims reach out for help, they are reminded of teachings like the one we heard today, that they are supposed to forgive 77 times. But I think there's more to forgiveness than that. In the cycle of abuse, forgiveness keeps victims trapped. Forgiveness should never trap us. It should free us. In the cycle of abuse, forgiveness keeps things from changing. Forgiveness should not keep things the same. Forgiveness should be an instrument of transformation. South African Archbishop Desmond Tutu, who led South Africa through a process of reconciliation in the wake of the fall of apartheid, knows quite a lot about forgiveness. And in his recent book, he speaks of forgiveness having four steps. The first step, he says, is telling the story. Forgiveness does not mean sweeping what happened under the rug. It does not mean silence and secrecy. Forgiveness requires us to tell the story, to name what happened, and to acknowledge it. The second step, he says, is naming the hurt. It is not true or helpful to say that a violent act or a harmful act or a cruel act was no big deal. It ignores the hurt. You have to name the hurt and the harm that was done. If no harm was done, then no forgiveness is necessary. Recognizing and articulating the pain opens the door for forgiveness. The third step, he names, is asking for and offering forgiveness. A reporter asked Desmond Tutu about this step. He said he asked whether the perpetrator had to repent and ask for forgiveness. And Tutu replied that while it was better for the perpetrator if they did so, forgiveness could take place without their involvement. He said if forgiving depends on the culprit owning up, then the victim would always be at the mercy of the perpetrator. As the victim, you offer the gift of your forgiving to the perpetrator, who may or may not appropriate the gift, but it has been offered, and thereby it liberates the victim. The final step in Tutu's fourfold path of forgiveness is renewing or releasing the relationship. Not every instance of forgiveness can or should lead to an ongoing relationship between victim and perpetrator. Indeed, in abusive relationships, it is often better for both if the relationship is released. Another aspect of forgiveness, one that Tutu understands implicitly, even if he doesn't highlight explicitly, is this. Forgiveness happens in community, not behind locked doors of secrecy and shame, not in silence and darkness and hiding. The parable that Jesus tells speaks of fellow slaves who witness the king's act of forgiveness and hold the vengeful slave accountable when he fails to respond with grace and mercy toward his neighbor. Forgiveness doesn't mean hitting the reset button. It means going through a process of letting go of one's anger and desire for revenge. It means giving up the right to get even. It means cutting the ties of debt and scorecards that keep us shackled to those who have harmed us. God's forgiveness is boundless and immeasurable. God meets us where we are and forgives us when we fall short. But not so that we can keep on in the same old errors and mistakes. We are forgiven with unimaginable grace and love so that we can be liberated from old harmful patterns, liberated into new ways of living. When we hear Jesus' teaching to forgive 77 times, we hear that we should forgive abundantly, boundlessly, and that is true. Forgiveness is about letting go of our obsession with getting even, settling up, keeping score. And if we count our acts of forgiveness, keeping track of them and limiting them, we are missing the point. But forgiveness is supposed to change things, too. Forgiveness is not supposed to keep us trapped in cycles of violence and harm, looping through the same events over and over and over again like the characters on that television show. Forgiving does not mean forgetting what happened and going back to the way things were. Forgiveness, God's forgiveness of us, our forgiveness of others, others' forgiveness of us, frees us from those cycles, lifting from us the burdens of sin and violence and pain, so that we can live more fully into who God calls us to be, people of peace.